This video is about cataract, what a cataract is, how cataract surgery is done, and a short discussion about lens implants and the laser procedure sometimes done after surgery. I hope you find it informative and interesting. Hello, my name is Craig Blackwell. I'm an ophthalmologist in sunny Santa Cruz, California. What we're making here is a set of videos about common eye conditions, for example, cataract, glaucoma, and macular degeneration. To get started, we need to get you oriented to the eyeball. So I'm going to show you here on the eye model, and I'll bring this over to you, and a little more light here. So here's the half-open eye. The cornea is the clear window in front. The iris is the colored part. The hole in the middle of the iris is the pupil. As it opens and closes, it regulates the amount of light that gets into the eye. Then behind the iris is the lens, just like the lens in a camera. And lining the inside of the eye is the retina. That's where the rods and cones are located that receive light and turn that into nerve impulses, which travel along the optic nerve back to the brain. So the things we're going to talk about are cataract as it relates to clouding of the lens, macular degeneration relating to deterioration of the retina, and glaucoma as it relates to damage to the optic nerve. So that's where we're headed next. In this segment, we are going to talk about cataract. Looking at the diagram of a side view of the eye, you can see the cornea, the clear window in front, the iris, the colored part, and behind that the lens, here highlighted in blue. This is a photo of the lens as seen through the microscope we use to examine the eye. What you see at the bottom of the picture is the edge of the lower eyelid. The pupil is widely dilated. If you look carefully, you can see the curved edge of the iris making almost a complete circle. On the left, the vertical beam of light is seen as it cuts through the curve of the cornea, here highlighted by the two arrowheads. Then there's a dark space for the anterior chamber. Then the beam of light is seen cutting through the lens. The three arrows point to the back surface of the lens. Here is a diagram explaining what you are looking at. If it's hard to understand, you can pause here and digest the image. Hopefully, this view of the lens is now easier to visualize because we will be looking at more pictures like this. In a teenager, the lens would be clearer. In this lens, belonging to a person of about age 50, you can see the beginning of color change to a kind of sea green. Over time, in everyone, the lens will progressively change in color and clarity, becoming yellower and hazier and harder to see through. When clouding of the lens interferes with vision, we call it a cataract. Development of cataract can be accelerated by a number of things, among them prednisone use, diabetes, and lifetime ultraviolet exposure. We measure cataract by how much it reduces vision. Here is a picture of moderate clouding of the lens with vision at about 20/30. Reduction to 20/40 is significant because this is usually where cloudy vision noticeably interferes with daily activities, and this is the level where medical insurance generally covers cataract surgery. This is a photo of a densely opaque cataract. Vision here would only be the ability to distinguish light and dark. You don't see many cataracts this cloudy. The decision to have cataract surgery is an individual choice depending on the demands of your occupation and daily activities. Someone with demanding visual needs, for example a professional photographer, might have cataract surgery with less vision impairment than someone who is retired and doesn't drive. Also factoring into the decision to have cataract surgery is vision potential. If the retina or optic nerve are not healthy, for instance, if there is significant macular degeneration, then vision may not improve very much even if the cloudy lens is removed. And while modern technology makes the surgery low risk, it does not make it no risk. So the decision to have surgery should be arrived at with careful discussion with your ophthalmologist, taking all these factors into account. To understand what goes on in cataract surgery requires a basic understanding of the anatomy of the lens. This illustration is meant to show that the lens has distinct parts. A Californian might make an analogy to an avocado. There's a skin layer on the outside, the capsule, a hard pit in the center, the nucleus, and a layer of softer material in between. Here are the steps involved in cataract surgery. First, before surgery starts, you are given a relaxing medication. Once in the operating room, the eye is prepped with antibacterial solution and sterile drapes are placed around the eye. Anesthesia consists of numbing drops on the surface and then a numbing solution irrigated inside the eye once it's open. A small incision is made about a quarter of an inch wide in the edge of the cornea. To access the inside of the lens, the front part of the capsule is opened and removed. Here is the big technology part. A phaco instrument uses high-frequency ultrasound to break up the lens and vacuum out the fragments. Note this next part. With removal of the cloudy lens material, the capsule is intentionally left in place because it will hold the lens implant. Let us consider the lens implant. All implants share the same general structure. There is a central optic which replaces the focusing power of the natural lens that was removed, and two arms that hold the lens centered within the capsule. The modern lens is made up of a flexible material that can be rolled up, inserted through the quarter-inch corneal incision, and once inside the eye, it unfolds within the lens capsule. Here is a picture of an IOL shown in place in the capsule at the end of surgery. The pupil is dilated. The arrows point to the edge of the optic part of the IOL. A big feature of the IOL is that you can choose the implant power to end up with the glasses prescription you want. Think about that. That makes this a form of refractive surgery. If you started out either near or farsighted, that can be corrected by choice of the lens implant power. That is a big deal. And the technology continues to improve, especially in lens implant design. New lens implants are advancing from the traditional single-focus lens to multifocal lenses. This is one kind of multifocal called a resume lens. The illustration is showing that different areas of the lens focus light from different distances. This is a crystal lens, an example of an implant that changes focus by moving within the eye in response to action of the focusing muscles, more closely mimicking the natural action of the human eye. The last thing we have time to cover is to answer a question I get frequently: can the cataract grow back? The simple answer is no. Once the cataract is removed, it is gone. However, the lens capsule that was left behind to hold the implant can become cloudy at some time after surgery. The arrow in this photo is pointing to clouding of the capsule layer behind the implant. To me, it looks like a layer of wax paper. It serves to make vision cloudy, just like the original cataract. The solution, however, is simpler. We can use a laser to make an opening, a window in that cloudy layer. This diagram is showing how the YAG laser can create an opening in that cloudy posterior lens capsule. Here is an after photo with the arrow showing the edge of the opening in the posterior capsule. I hope this information has been useful. Remember, this is for informational purposes only and does not replace an exam and discussion with your ophthalmologist. More in-depth information is available at my website, blackwelleyesight.com. Thank you.